A very good day to each and one of you present over here for this international conference. I am Dr. Leena Raje, principal of Srimati M.M.P. Shah College of Arts and Commerce, Mumbai, India. I am the principal investigator for this project, and she is my colleague, Ms. Amrita Behel, assistant professor of Srimati P.N. Doshi Women's College, Mumbai, India. The work that we are going to present in front of you today is gestational diabetes mellitus and pregnancy outcomes of urban Indian women. This project was taken up because it has a lot of social relevance. Gestational diabetes mellitus, commonly referred to as GDM, is defined as carbohydrate intolerance which is recognized during pregnancy. It shows the first onset during pregnancy only. It has lot of importance so far as women's health is concerned along with her offspring. The prevalence of GDM all over the world is increasing, and it is today affecting between 1 to 14% of all pregnancies. There is global increase because the women around a reproductive age are becoming more and more obese, and because of that there is gradual and steep increase in GDM. Women are at a greater risk for the disease development, especially the diabetes mellitus type 2 after pregnancy. Obesity and other factors that promote insulin resistance also appear to enhance the risk of type 2 diabetes after gestational diabetes mellitus develops. There is an increase in the risk of type 2 diabetes all along your life. Offsprings of these women also are at a greater risk because they may develop later on obesity, glucose intolerance and diabetes either in late adolescence or young adulthood. This diabetes which develops in the gestation is thus a threat to the mother and to the baby, having effect on the two generations. So far as the obstetric performance of the woman is concerned, there are also a lot of effects. Labor is induced quite early in the pregnancy period. Mode of delivery could be spontaneous vaginal delivery, or there could be vacuum or extraction or forceps needed during the delivery. There is also effect on the gestational age at birth. The children, the fetus is being born at a much younger gestational age than normal. There is also fear of pregnancy-induced hypertension and preeclampsia. So far as the neonates are concerned, they are also not spared. There could be effect on their birth weight, especially the macrosomia, leading to higher birth weight babies. Babies could be born at a shorter gestational age. There could be fear of preterm delivery, and a 5-minute Apgar score after the baby is born could be abnormal. There is a fear of stillbirth, there is a fear of neonatal death, also there could be birth trauma and neonatal hypoglycemia and hyperbilirubinemia. Considering all these factors, it definitely looks that gestational diabetes is definitely a major concern in today's pregnant women. Therefore, it was decided that this is a socially relevant topic and we need to address this issue. So this present work was taken up with this idea. Lot of review of the literature was done, and some very recent researches carried out by various researchers have given us some idea about the risk factors for gestational diabetes mellitus. The important ones are listed in this slide. I think let us start with the adolescent girl. So there is a history of polycystic ovarian syndrome. A girl who has been suffering with polycystic ovarian syndrome, there is a higher incidence in her for development of gestational diabetes. There could be more prenatal morbidity from GDM. She could suffer from pregnancy-induced hypertension, and there could be preeclampsia during pregnancy. Next important factor is excessive gestational weight gain. This is a modifiable risk factor, and it has a greater effect because there is maternal fat deposition. which leads to impaired insulin sensitivity. Next important factor is advanced maternal age. Today, because of lot of factors in our society, girls get married at a later age. Beyond 35 years of age, there is increased prevalence of GDM. Lot of studies have pointed out that there is a positive significant correlation with the maternal age. Also, there are lot of problems seen in the today's generation so far as the weight management is concerned. There are many girls who are overweight, obese and leading a sedentary lifestyle. Maternal obesity has a known association with poor maternal and fetal outcomes, including the gestational diabetes mellitus. Height of the woman is also very important. It has been found out that women who are shorter than 159 centimeters are reported to have higher prevalence of GDM with a very high significance level. There is increased exposure of children to some of the endocrine disrupting systems, and that could lead to early sexual maturation and thus having more fear for miscarriages and as well as development of GDM. As I already mentioned, preeclampsia has also increased the risk of diabetes mellitus almost 2 to 4 fold. And if the woman is already having type 1 diabetes, then the risk is all the more greater. Thus, overall we can say that there are so many factors which have interplay and which contribute to development of gestational diabetes mellitus. The present study was taken up with the hypothesis that there is adverse effect on pregnancy outcome that is seen if a woman is suffering because of gestational diabetes mellitus. For the study, we laid down the following objectives: to record monthly weight gain pattern, dietary intake and blood glucose levels of pregnant women diagnosed with gestational diabetes mellitus, and this generally happens in the second or third trimester. To observe the pregnancy outcomes of women who are diagnosed with gestational diabetes mellitus, and finally to study the correlation between GDM and pregnancy outcome. Methodology that was adopted by us for this research study: we first took the permission and approval of the Institutional Ethics Committee of Navrosji Wadia Maternal Hospital, Parel, Mumbai. This especially caters to the women of low socioeconomic group. 100 pregnant women with GDM were selected and they gave a consent to participate in the study. Data collection was done using the following modality. A general questionnaire was prepared and that was used to collect socio-demographic details. Anthropometric data including height in centimeters, weight in kg, BMI calculated as per kg per meter square was done, and monthly gestational weight gain record was maintained. Plasma glucose levels were recorded from the hospital records. We also administered 24-hour food record and food frequency questionnaire to collect the data on the dietary habits and dietary intake of these pregnant women. Pregnancy outcome was tested using the parameters like duration of gestation, type of delivery, whether it is normal delivery, cesarean section or whether any forceps delivery. Neonatal birth weight was taken as one of the most important indicators, and APGAR score till the end of 5 minutes duration was also measured. Thus, the study was conducted using this following methodology.
So the data was analyzed using means for anthropometric parameters like weight, height, BMI and the monthly gestational weight gain, which was obtained from the hospital records. Correlations were studied between the maternal parameters and the pregnancy outcomes, like anthropometric parameters of the mother and the neonatal birth weight, maternal plasma glucose levels, the neonatal birth weight and the type of delivery the mother underwent, the gestational week of delivery and the neonatal birth weight, and the APGAR score of the neonates. Coming to the results and discussions, as can be seen, most of the women were recruited in the third trimester, with some of them in the second trimester. And since they were women who were diagnosed with GDM, they did have higher fasting plasma blood glucose as well as postprandial blood glucose levels, as is obvious from this slide. When we studied the association between plasma glucose levels and the pregnancy outcomes, it was seen that women, statistically significant associations were found between maternal plasma glucose levels through the gestational period and the type of delivery, indicating that higher mean fasting plasma glucose levels and postprandial blood glucose levels through the pregnancy were associated with the C-section. Whereas women who had near normal plasma glucose levels, even though they were diagnosed with GDM, did have normal deliveries. As far as the macronutrient intake and the pregnancy outcomes were concerned, most of the women when they were diagnosed with GDM were prescribed oral hypoglycemic drugs to manage glucose levels through the pregnancy, and that led to a minor decrease in their plasma glucose levels. But even then, women who had a higher intake of macronutrients, as can be seen from table 4, the women who had a higher intake of energy, protein, carbohydrate, and a total caloric intake being higher throughout pregnancy did have to undergo a cesarean section because the babies were macrosomic when they were born. The gestational week of delivery, type of delivery, and the neonatal birth weight, we found statistically significant associations between the type of delivery the mother underwent and the birth weight of the newborn. As was obvious that women had their gestational period within the normal range, but as we can see that women who had normal blood glucose levels and a normal gestational weight gain pattern had longer gestational periods as opposed to women who had had a higher blood glucose levels through the pregnancy, they had a shorter gestational period. And this association was also statistically significant. As per this table, a negative correlation did exist between the birth weight of the newborn and the gestational week of delivery. That is, a shorter gestational period had been observed when the birth weights were higher. So macrosomic infants necessitated a early delivery for women who had to undergo a cesarean section. However, when the Apgar scores were noted of these infants, Apgar score, as we all know, is a measure of vitality shortly after birth, and a low Apgar score has been strongly associated with cerebral palsy. In the present study, almost all the infants who were born, in fact all the infants who were born, had an Apgar score of normal, that is more than 7. So through our study, we have concluded that the birth weight of the infants was significantly affected by fasting and postprandial blood glucose levels, in that higher mean fasting and postprandial blood glucose levels were very significantly associated with a cesarean delivery and a birth of a macrosomic child. And therefore, we can say that this influenced the type of delivery such that higher birth weights necessitated a cesarean section delivery, while those women who underwent normal deliveries gave birth to babies with comparatively lower birth weights, indicating a healthier prognosis for the children later.
However, there were limitations for the study. The small sample size of the study was because of our time constraint in the data collection. Also, conducting the study with a large number of subjects also will be helping us in the validation of the data that has been found out in this study. There may be some contribution of this study to establish guidelines for the management of gestational diabetes mellitus, because of which there can be better pregnancy outcomes ensured, so that in the affected population we can do something because of which this incidences will be reduced, and overall the population, that is in the next generation, we can say that they will become more healthy. However, we would like to extend this study to a more number so that we get a data can also come out with some more accurate findings. Thank you very much.